Hello, everyone. We have a new one for you today. So I was referred this case for 11, 12, and 13. Couldn't really see anything super obvious on the PA. When you look at the cone beam, same thing here. Not anything really obvious there. And then you get inside the mouth, you can see the drainage signing tract there. So ended up doing some testing. 11 and 13 were both totally fine. 12, however, is necrotic. It does appear that class 5 was the culprit here, that it was close enough to go in and take that tooth out. So showing you how the case starts, we use these logic block bite blocks. They are way more comfortable than the traditional ones because they have that cutout in them, so there's a little more space for the tongue. Patients really like that. And just doing single tooth isolation here because we're just going to be making a very small hole through the top of it. So kind of showing you that process. Make sure you always invert your dam. That's one of my pet peeves. But as you can see, not really much going on as far as this tooth goes. So when we're looking at it here, I'm going to try to plan out the axis to be as conservative as possible. This tooth will eventually get a crown, just because I know who the general dentist is on this one, and they do like to crown these teeth. But this is one where, you know, if we can keep it small enough, sometimes you can get away with not needing one if there's no crack. So kind of a controversial subject, but anyway, let's go ahead and get going here as far as what we're going to do. Starting off here, I'm going to use, for my axis, I'm going to start by flattening the tooth off. And you can see that looks absolutely terrible. So let's go ahead and use the mirror magic from Zerk, and you will see how much better this mirror looks here in just a second, and voila. So that's why I absolutely love that stuff, and it doesn't create that nice hydrophobic layer on top of there, so the water just beads up instead of, you know, causing all these issues. So starting off here, we're going to be adjusting the occlusion. A lot of dentists will use the existing design of the crown when they're making their CAD CAM, and so I found that it's nice to kind of soften those cusps a little bit, because let's be real, if every tooth did have root canal implant occlusion, if the root canal one did, we'd have far less issues. So one of the things I like to do, as far as what we're going to start off with here, I'm starting off with the EG3 burr from SS White. It is a excellent burr. They are expensive, but they do work extremely well. And the reason I'm using this here is, you'll see in a second, I'm going to switch to it using a long tapered diamond. I've found that recently the batches that I've had, it just strips the diamonds off from the very tip of it, which is very annoying. So I like to get that initial kind of purchase and with the EG3, and then I take this 850 burr, we call it the workhorse from SS White, and that's what I do most of my access with. And this is pretty much the one burr that I use on every single case, is this 850. It's really skinny, it's at 014. So it doesn't create a large access shape, so we're still being nice and conservative. I can use it for troughing for MB2s. We can use it to prep teeth. It's a very versatile burr and one of my absolute favorites here. So we're going to go ahead and keep on dropping down. And then in this case, we don't normally get it, but I actually got a drop into the actual chamber. Always fun when you get that. Going to start off here. So we have two canals, as you can see, buccal and lingual. And when we go through the process, I like to start off with an 8C here. So I'm taking this to about the working length that I got from the cone beam. It's really important to go through the cone beam beforehand, get all the information that you can from it. And then I'm going to take a 2006. This is the Brassler VT Scout. I switched to these about a year ago and have absolutely loved them. They work extremely well. And this just kind of gets out any coronal impediments that might be in my way for when I need to go get my length. I have now switched to using the Brassler Triton instead of the traditional bleach and EDTA. It is more expensive than just getting the, you know, generic bleach and EDTA. However, it does seem to do a better job of getting things nice and clean and dry, and I felt more comfortable being able to one-step cases, and that's the reason why I've switched to it. So we're going to go ahead, and at this point, we are ready to get length. So we've figured out how many canals there are, clean out the top part, and it is length time. So for length, I like to dry it as best as possible using that microsuction. I'm using the Root ZX from Merida, and I use a 25 length 10K file to get length. I like to go to full length, so that means that we pull right back from where the red is, and that gets a very accurate amount. I found that the 0.5 back can be, well, very variable, and the 0.0 tends to be the most accurate one. So that's something I changed recently, and it's been my lengths have been a lot better for that. So I'm going to check these two. I do have ruled mirror handles. I know that just popped up on the screen. And if you don't have these, they're a great time saver because they're right on there. I have two in each kit so that if one mirror drops, I can still get lengths. And this way I don't have to carry around the endo ring or anything like that. So those are from EIE. I can put a link in the description if you guys are interested because I really like those. And we're going to go ahead and do our final shaping here with a 1704. We're going to full working length to make sure that that is as clean as possible. And this is what our final shape's going to be. So nothing too aggressive here. We want to keep things nice and conservative. I like to keep the initial shape as close to as what nature gave us and don't want to really remove excess tooth structure. So we're going to now do our final rinse here. This is with the Triton. Just kind of rinsing it out until I don't see anything coming up. That's always a question, is when do you finish rinsing? And for me, it's once everything's nice and clean and we don't see any debris coming up, that's pretty much when I'm happy, as long as there's no more drainage. I'm usually comfortable at that point to fill. I do like to use the endoactivator. You're going to see that here in just a second. And that kind of just dislodges any debris still inside there. You'll often see that after you run this, the liquid becomes a little more cloudy because there's some debris hiding either in, you know, lateral canals or different isthmuses or whatever it may be. So going back and rinsing that out again, just making sure everything one last time is as clean as possible and that there's nothing coming up anymore. So we're going to finish up our rinse here and then start to do our drying process. So for the drying process, I like to use that microsuction. Once again, it's an incredible little tool. If you don't have one of these, you can get adapters to work with the assistant side suction. But if you're building an office or have the ability to add it to your cart, I highly recommend it. They work extremely well. And I, once again, use this on every case as well. A little blast there with the air only Stropco. Once again, low pressure on that. So I'm not worried about air embolisms. And then just paper points. The nice part about this technique is that I really only have to use one or two paper points and I'm done. You'll see me here testing the paper points against the rubber dam. I want to make sure that there's no more liquid down there. So if I can poke it and it holds in place, we're good to go. So that's what the picture looks like. Nice and clean for the buccal and lingual. And we're going to go ahead and start doing our obturation. We're going to do the squirt technique here, coneless, AH plus sealer, like I talked about last time. Fan of the Brassler stuff, but it just seems to not work well in my hands for this technique. So coming in here with the B&L, the 20K file first, we got to get that all the way down to working length. Once again, with the squirt technique, you need to be patent and you need to have zero things in the way of the gutta percha as it's going down. So I like to use that 20K file just to apically clear, make sure that I have a clean path all the way to the apex. And now we're going to come in and do our squirt technique. So B&L beta mini for this one, make sure you use that soft gutta percha. I run this at 230 degrees, so it's nice and hot, and then come right back in with the plugger. Now, you notice there's a gap there, and that is because there was no gutta percha in it. The one thing I do love about this device from B&L is how quick it is to reload it. So this little pause right here, that's how long it took to pull that out, put a new gutta percha pellet in there, and you're good to go. Calamus users, that's not going to be an option for you. So going back in with that plugger, once again, that Nitai is beautiful to create that apical pressure that we need for this technique, and as well as go around any potential bends. This is a pretty straight tooth. But for curved ones, you can rely on that Nitai more than you can for a stainless steel. So going back and forth here, making sure that we fill these up. And at this point, I'm trying to decide whether or not I'm going to be doing one post or two. I like to place posts inside these teeth just to help prevent a snap-off failure. I'll talk about that in a second. But the consideration for one versus two is really what is the emergence out of the canal going to look like? And in this case, the buccal canal was nice and straight and in line, or in the long axis with the tooth, and that's where you need it to be. If you look at in a second here, when the plugger goes in for that palatal, it's almost coming out the buccal cusp tip at that angle, and really that's not going to do anything as far as the post. So I'm just going to do a single one here and make sure we get that nice and cleaned up. So at this point, obturation's done. We're going to clean up that mess using some isopropyl alcohol, scrub that off, and then rinse to make sure we get it nice and clean. And then at this point, we're going to be test fitting our post and getting everything looking, or getting everything ready for the x-ray to make sure everything looks great. So that's what you're seeing here. Going in with that post, I usually use the B&L alpha to create my post space here. It's a nice 4504 tip. This way I'm not removing any excess tooth structure, and I can control it because the size post that I usually use is a 5004 from Brassler. The 4504 seems to be a nice, I've done it with the 50, but I was getting little voids right at the, right at that junction between the gutta percha and the post itself. And so the 45 goes just slightly farther, and I think it allows the composite to better encase the post. Does any of this matter? Probably not. But these are this is my thought process. Just kind of want to share it with you. So at this point, I am annoyed by this little, piece of gutta percha in the isthmus here. So I'm just going to use a Hedstrom here, and I'm going to speed this up because, once again, a little finicky. I want things to be as clean and perfect as possible. We don't want any sloppiness in the final one. So this is me just still cleaning as we still clean. And eventually we get it to a point where I'm pretty happy with it. Let's go ahead and place that post inside here. I have on certain cases, I found that these accessory posts work better. And as you can see from that x-ray, that does not look good. So we got to go back in and fix it. I'll talk about that post here in just a second. As far as how we're going to fix it, you can see that there was a gap between where the post and the gutta percha meet. So I'm going to measure this right now, and we're at 13.5. And that way I know if I backfill my gutta percha up to 13.5 millimeters as measured on the plugger, that post is going to fit just perfectly here. For the palatal, I'm just going to hit that with the PacMac, make sure we get that nice and clean, don't have any issues with that void. And that's what this device is designed to do. It spins it, apically compacts that gutta percha, pushes it down to where it needs to go, and then fixes the void. So going back in here with that plugger, trying to get that nice look for the palatal. And once again, there's still some junk in the middle, so let's speed this up. I just don't like having that gutta percha in the isthmus. I want to completely encase the post. And so this is sped up at 3 times, just as you see as I'm finically, is that a word, finically? I guess it is now, as I'm trying to get this as clean as possible inside here. So we're still going, almost there, almost there. You'll see here in a second, going back down the buckle. And at this point, I am going to measure, make sure that we're at the right length. So put my post back in. I'm going to make sure that we're all the way apically as possible. And I'm measuring this here is what you're seeing. So I'm going to pop that off and measure. And we are right at 13, which is where my plugger went to. So I'm very happy with that. Pop that guy in and let's take a look at the x-ray. Very happy with that now. So it looks good as far as where the post goes to, little puff at the end, but there still is that little piece in the isthmus. And so let's go after it again. Once again, Hedstrom seemed to do the best job. You can see I'm getting a little piece out of there. I did put a 90 degree bend on this just to try to grab it a little bit more. And you will see it pop off here in 1, 2, 3. I am going to go ahead and slow that back down just so everybody can join in my enjoyment of getting that piece out. And so now we have two beautiful circles of pink for the picture, which we will take here in just a second. And before we do that, I'm going to disclose. This is the BioClear disclosing solution. I talked about this in my last video. I'm a big fan of this stuff. It does pretty much gives you a paint by numbers approach to figure out where the biofilm is. And then you can come in with their little blaster and selectively just air etch and abrade the area to make sure that there's no, that you have the best possible bond that you can have on this tooth. And so that's what we're doing here. You'll notice I switch mirrors. This is just a size 4 whatever mirror from Henry Schein that I don't care about. We were using it with my small size 0 mirrors, but they're very expensive. And even though the BioClear Blaster is softer than traditional air abrasion methods, I was finding that we were scratching those mirrors super quickly. So you'll notice we swap mirrors quite a lot here. I have 3 of them just because we have different purposes for them. Most of the time I'm using that size 0, but I also have a different photo mirror that's a size 5 from Zurich, and then I have the size 4 for retraction and for blasting. So total etch technique as far as getting this bonding done. I'm gonna let that soak, rinse that off, and then we're gonna come in here and make sure everything looks beautiful. I like to take my picture right after the etch because it gives you that really nice matte finish, and I've noticed that that mattness, if that's a word, has actually increased after using the etcher, so or the blaster, and it really does create these beautiful photos where everything looks nice and clean, there's no glare, and you can see, yep, we got both canals looking great. So at this point, the palatal canal is filled all the way up with gutta percha, and the buckle has the post space inside there. So we're going to be using the Clearfill SE, going in there and getting that scrubbed in. You'll notice here in a second, I forgot to turn the UV filter on the microscope, and so I'll panic and get that fixed here in a second. But we're coming in. I'm not really worried about the prime as much, but the bond is very sensitive to light. We have to mix this immediately beforehand, right before we use it, because if you let it set for any longer, even the ambient light in the room will start to set it up. So you want to have as little UV light on there as possible. Air thin with the air only strop coat, as we've talked about, and we're going to go ahead and do our 20-second light cure. I sped this up because everyone knows what light cure looks like. Not a big deal there. And then we're going to go ahead and get this filled up. So what we're going to use to fill this up is Luxacor A3 in a Centrix tube. This is a blue one. It's a little smaller, so I can place the top of it right on top of the gutta percha. And our composite gun is going bad, so you saw it go flying there. This is going to result in a small void in the final image. When you're doing this, you want to try to backfill in one solid swoop without taking that tip out. That's going to minimize your chance of getting a void in your composite there. And we're going to come in here with the post. I like to then come back in with the Centrix tube after using the post, because there's usually a little divot or kind of a void that's created by that. Backfill one more time. I'm going to compact this down with the Glick to make sure that everything is nice and I don't have to do as much cleanup at the end. And then we're going to go through a 20-second light cure again. So getting that all set up nice. Luxacor is a dual cure material, so really the 20 seconds light cure on the top is to harden the most coronal aspect so I can go in and polish it. So we're gonna come in here with that same wheelbarrow as before. I just wanna get it down to where the natural tooth structure is. I did take this tooth slightly out of the bite. Like I said, this will be getting a crown on top of it, but I don't wanna leave any, you know, non-working interferences that could cause issues with the tooth. And so getting that looking nice and clean, get that piece of gutta percha out of there so we don't have that in the photo. And that is what it looks like. So that little dot in the middle is that post. And we like to use those posts just to prevent snap-off failures in these cases. This is a great general dentist, so I know he's going to do a really conservative crown, but just in case it ends up getting prepped with like a 2 millimeter margin one day, that post is going to be pretty much the only thing holding on. So finalizing the case here with this barrel diamond, I found this is the great last burr to use because it softens any right angles that was created by that wheel diamond, gets everything nice and smooth. This is one of my absolute favorite burrs. Shout out to Sac Valley once again for introducing this to me. I hadn't really used this burr ever, and I wish I had it in dental school in my entire career. So a link to that one in the description as well if you guys want to purchase it. I'm going to get the nice pretty picture here. I forgot to put Mirror Magic on the Zerk mirror, as you can see. So we're going to get that looking nice and clean. And then you'll see what everything looks like as far as the picture. And we'll go to those final x-rays there as well. So I did want to check the bite here just to make sure that we're out of the bite. You'll see there's just a little bit from the lateral right on the tip. I'm not worried about that. That's just from the excursive forces. And this is what the final looks like. So not super happy with that void, obviously, but when the composite gun popped off like that, there really isn't much you can do. Otherwise, the case, I'm very pleased with it. I think it's nice and conservative. We gave this guy a really good treatment, and this was done relatively quickly. I think the whole case took under 20 minutes from start to finish, and that's one of the beautiful things with how we are doing endodontics these days is the days of 3-hour root canals are pretty much gone. Sometimes cases take, you know, extra time, and I totally get that. This is definitely a straightforward one for me. But with these modern techniques and having really well-trained assistants, you can get these cases done in a much shorter amount of time than in the past. So anyway, thank you guys so much for watching this video. If you have any questions, leave them below. If you'd like to see different videos on anything, please let me know as well. I'm still playing around with this. I also recorded this one at 10 times zoom instead of the 4 like the last one. So let me know which one you guys prefer. My endo buddies probably want the 4 times so they can see the passing and everything going on. And I would assume everyone else wants to see the action is zoomed into the tooth. So I will be back here probably, hopefully going to get another video up next week. But once again, I make these videos for you guys. So let me know if there's anything you'd like to see. Thanks.